Gildan Media proudly presents Gildan Seminars, original lectures containing essential information that can be applied to every facet of life and business.
Thank you, Jerry. Great to be with you. Thank you very much. I know how challenging it is for you living in Cleveland to come out on a beautiful summer evening like this when you could be outside, and I appreciate you doing that. I guess I haven't been in Cleveland for quite a while because it's beautiful out there. You have done a terrific job with this city. You really have. With a lot of cities, with the downtown just disintegrating, you've done a wonderful job. So congratulations on that. I was in New York on Saturday, so I had to make a choice. Should I stay Sunday in New York and come to Cleveland late Sunday night, or should I take an early morning flight and be here? And I'm so glad I took the early morning flight. It gave me a chance to go out and see the tall ships, which I thought were terrific, the harbor, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, wonderful. Congratulations on what you've done with the city. Let me tell you what I think is one of the most interesting things that I have uncovered about negotiating in the 22 years now that I've been writing and talking about it. And that is that negotiating skills don't change as the negotiation gets bigger or more important. The same fundamental skills always apply. Something that you may learn this evening that tomorrow or next week will get you a little better price from a customer or save you from having to give away some terms or delivery prices. A year or two from now, you may be involved in a multi-million dollar merger or acquisition of another company. The same fundamental skills would apply. Even if you were involved in international arms control talks, the same fundamental skills apply. It's the most basic set of personal skills you'll ever develop. And once you develop it, you'll be using it in every area of your life. I find that fascinating because what it means is that once you've got the fundamentals down, then every time you turn on the television or open up the newspaper and see one of these high-profile negotiations going on, you'll know what the negotiators are doing, you'll know why they're doing it, and it becomes a continuing learning process for you. For example, you would immediately understand that the Middle East is in chaos because Ehud Barak, the former prime minister of Israel, made a fundamental negotiating mistake in dealing with Yasser Arafat. And I bet it's a mistake that we have all made in business at one time or another. We have been so eager to put a deal together that we have thought, I'm going to make this so good that the customer will not be able to say no to me. So Ehud Barak went to Yasser Arafat and said, here's what we'll do. We'll let you have your own nation. We'll give you East Jerusalem for your capital. And we'll give you back 97% of the land that we captured during the war. Now, that was a deal that was so good. So good that Yasser Arafat should have said, wow, I can't believe you're willing to do all that. That's fantastic. We'll take it. Thank you very much. That's what he should have done. But as you know from business, that's not always what happens, is it? Sometimes you make a deal so good that the buyer thinks, wow, I got them to give me this much. I wonder how much more I can give them, get them to give me, and the whole thing turns into chaos. So I thought I'd start out this evening by talking about a couple of international incidents, things that you read about in the newspaper at the time. And let's see what we can abstract from that and apply to your day-to-day sales negotiations. Let's go back to November 1994 in Port-au-Prince, Haiti. We had former President Carter sitting down with General Cedros to negotiate the return of democracy to Haiti or get the dictator out, depending on your point of view. The phone rang, and it was President Clinton saying, I have already started the invasion. You have 30 minutes to wrap up the negotiation and get out of there. Now, that's extreme time pressure on a negotiation, right? Extreme time pressure. And you all know that under time pressure, people become flexible. If that buyer wants what you've got and they've got to have it right now, price will not be the issue that it would be if they were working 6 months ahead of their needs curve. If you're buying something and you've got to have it right now, chances are you'll pay more for it than you would if you were 6 months ahead of your needs curve. Well, your children know about time pressure, don't they? When do they ask you for something? Just at the last minute, right? Just as you're racing out or they're racing out, that's when they know they have the best chance of getting something. Sometimes my younger son, John, would drive me over to Los Angeles Airport. That's about an hour's drive for us. And we don't talk about anything of consequence on the way over there until we get curbside, and the skycap's got the luggage on the cart. I'm about to race off and try and catch that plane, and I hear him saying, Dad, I'm sorry, I forgot. I need $50 to fix the muffler on my car. And I say, John, don't do this to me. I teach this stuff. How come it didn't come up before? And he says, well, Dad, I'm sorry I forgot, but I've got to fix the ticket on the car. I've got to get it done before you get back from the trip. Let me have the money now. I'll explain it when you get back. Instinctively, they understand that under time pressure, you become flexible. So here in Haiti with this phone call, we all of a sudden had enormous time pressure on this negotiation. The problem was President Clinton was putting time pressure on the wrong side. When you have all the power in a negotiation, you don't put time pressure on your own ambassador. It caused Carter to give away things like agreeing to rent the general's houses and other things that he didn't have to do. You put time pressure on the other side. Now, here's a key point about negotiating, and I think this is the most important thing to learn, to understand, and know how to apply when you're negotiating. We didn't have the power in Haiti because we had the larger army. We had the power in Haiti because we had the most options. Options give you power. We didn't have to do a thing. We didn't have to invade, but we had very effectively limited General Cedrus's options to just one or two countries around the world who would even take him in exile. He now runs a graphic arts business out of his apartment in Panama City. That's the best he could do out of that negotiation because we had so severely restricted his options. So if you can convince the other person that the result of this negotiation is not that critical to you because you have all of these options available to you, that gives you power in a negotiation. If at the same time you can limit the other person's perception of the options that they have, which you do by positioning yourself in the marketplace as different than everybody else. Oh, sure, there are lots of other people in this business who could sell you this, but nobody has the sales, service, and backup that we do. We are unique. Nobody does it the way we do it. That limits the perception of the options that the buyer has. Then you have power coming at you from the other side. So the buyer's job in a negotiation is to convince you that they have options. That, well, they've got six other people who will all sell it to them at a lower price than you do. That is just their job in the negotiation. It doesn't mean it's true. It's just that they've learned a thing or two about negotiating, and they know if they can convince you that they have options, that makes you vulnerable in the negotiation. Your job is to convince the buyer that your sales and service are unique, that nobody else can match what you do, and then you have the power in a negotiation. Let's talk about another international incident. Let's talk about the hostages being held in Beirut. One of them for 6.5 years. Perez de Cuellar, the UN Secretary General who got them out, would tell you that he got them out because he knew how to downplay the importance of the bargaining chip. He was finally able to convince those hostage takers that they didn't hold a very good bargaining chip there. We cared about these people, but we had warned them of the danger. We didn't care enough to change our policy on hostage taking, which is a very sensitive position to advance when people's lives are at stake. You will recall that President Carter did exactly the opposite. When he had the hostages in the Tehran embassy, he made it the focal point of his administration. He came right out and said, nothing is more important to me than getting these hostages out. I'm not going to leave Washington until we do. That is about the worst thing you can do in a negotiation. Just about the worst thing you can do is to let the other side know how much you care. I thought President Bush did an excellent job of getting our spy plane back from China. Remember that incident? We hit one of their planes and now we're on the ground. And George Bush is saying, well, you know, we'd like to get the plane back, but it's not that critical because we destroyed all the sensitive information and equipment on the way down. Oh, right, sure they did. They hit another plane in midair. They went into a spin. They had about 2 minutes before they were going to hit the ocean, and they were back there destroying the sensitive information and equipment. I don't think so. I think we desperately needed to get that plane back. That's not the way to negotiate, is it? Let the other side know how little you care, and you do a lot better in a negotiation. The hostage who was held longest in Beirut was Terry Anderson, the Associated Press bureau chief, held hostage for 6.5 years. He has a sister whose name is Peggy Say. And Peggy Say, financed by Associated Press, who should have known better, waged a battle for 6.5 years that we would never forget that her brother was being held hostage in Beirut. And everybody is saying, wasn't that wonderful? If you were being held hostage, wouldn't you love to have a sister like Peggy Say? Not me. I think it's very significant that he was the last prisoner released. I think she delayed his release by 2 years doing what she did. They probably didn't know why Terry Anderson was so important to us. All they knew was every time they opened up an American newspaper, here was Terry Anderson's picture on the front page. Don't let the other side know how much you care, and you do a lot better in a negotiation. So what I've been saying here is that negotiating skills are the same at any level of the game. The fundamental skills always apply. It's the most basic set of skill sets you'll ever develop. And once you do, you'll be using it in every area of your life. Okay, now let's talk about some basic negotiating tactics, beginning negotiating gambits. A gambit is a chess turn that means any maneuver for advantage. If you play chess, you know there are beginning gambits to get the game started in your direction. Then there are middle gambits to keep the momentum going. And then there are ending gambits when you get ready to checkmate the other person or, in business parlance, close the sale. These are the beginning negotiating gambits, the things you do in the early stages to be sure you're setting it up for a successful conclusion. Here's rule number one. Never jump at the first proposal, however good it looks. Because if you say yes to the first proposal, it automatically triggers two thoughts in the other person's mind. And those thoughts are so automatic, I'm going to have you tell me what they are. Let's say that you're thinking of buying a second car, and the people down the street have one for sale, and they're asking, let's say, $10,000 for it. At that, it is a terrific buy. There's not a thing wrong with the price. You can't wait to get down there and snap it up before somebody else beats you to it. But on the way down there, you start thinking to yourself, well, I'll be a good negotiator. Just to see what happens, I'll make them a super low offer. I'll offer them $8,000 for the car. Now, I know I'm not going to get it for that, but maybe we'll end up splitting the difference. It'll be an even better buy. Now, I want you to relate that to a buyer that you're about to close this sale with them. And they have already made the decision to do business with you. They've gone through all of the discussions. That decision has been made. They're going to do business with you. But at the last minute, the buyer is thinking, well, why don't I just make them a super low offer just to see what happens? So you sit down with the husband and wife that own the automobile. You present your $8,000 offer. You're waiting for them to explode with rage at such a low offer. What actually happens is one looks at the other and says, well, what do you think, dear? And the other one says, oh, let's go ahead and sell it and get rid of it. What is your first reaction? Are you sitting there thinking, wow, what a terrific negotiator I am. I could not have got a better deal. Is that what you're thinking? I don't think so. What are you thinking? Could have done better. Should have gone in lower. Now, the interesting thing about that is it has absolutely nothing to do with the price. It only has to do with the way they reacted to the proposal. What if they'd have gone in at $7,000 or $6,000 or $5,000 and they said, sure, we'll take that. Wouldn't you still think you could have done better? It has nothing to do with the price. What would your second reaction be if they jumped at a low offer on that automobile that you didn't expect them to take? Something's wrong with it, right? I need to back off and take another look at this. If they're willing to say yes to an offer that I didn't think they would, there must be something going on that I don't understand. I need to back off and take another look at this. And these same two thoughts will go through anybody's mind anytime you say okay to the first suggestion. If your son came to you and said, could I borrow the car tonight?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.